this time together. It's a blessing to be in your house. Father, we know that there are those that couldn't be here this morning for whatever the reason. We ask you, Lord, to be with them. Father, be with us as we have our service. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. 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 Wave at your neighbor. Don't shake hands, right? But you can say hello. It's good to have you with us today. And I'd like to welcome you today if you happen to be here visiting. There are some visitors with us, so we're grateful that you're with us. And hope that you enjoy the service today. In the way of announcements, if you'd like to know, look there on the back of your bulletin. The Annie Armstrong Easter offering is ahead of us. You know, Easter's what?
2 weeks
from today. All right, so it's a week after next. So next Sunday will be good. Next Friday will be good Friday, right? Okay, how all that works. And so be getting ready for this. We have decided to have breakfast Easter morning, like we usually do, and normally we will have a service at 8 o'clock, and we'll do that this year, and then have Brotherhood back fixing some breakfast, and we'll eat breakfast after that, about 9 o'clock, and then after we get through that, get all cleaned up, we'll have Sunday school at 10 o'clock, and then we all call service off in the evening that day, because we've had such a long day as it is. And so that'll be 2 weeks from today at Easter. All right, community Easter egg hunt. I don't know if you all got this, but you can hang this up if you want to. Susie fixed it for us, but it'll be the Saturday before Easter. So that's 2 weeks from yesterday. 3 o'clock, and we don't have a time on there to end. We just put it on there at 3 because we don't know what the weather's going to do, right? And if it goes to rain, we won't be going inside because we want to keep it out where we're all clear. Amen. So you can see there what it says, ages 2 to 12 years old, sponsored by Trinity Baptist Church, and it will be at the Nectar Ballpark down here at the behind the town hall in Nectar. All right. Amen. Are there any other announcements? All right. Do we have any birthdays? Didn't even look. Right. Celebrate any birthdays? Today is. We do have some, but not anybody that's here, right? Do we have any anniversaries? No anniversaries? No March brides then, huh? You think so?
They are.
All right.
Yeah.
Okay. In the way of prayer request, we have several names on the list. I'd like to mention, we'll be in prayer for our personnel committee with the association. I mentioned this earlier today in the announcements at Sunday school time, but I wanted to mention it to you also. Brother Ernie, you know, has announced his retirement, and that will be effective 1st of May, and so the personnel committee will be getting together to find a new director of missions, and this is quite a big task, and so please be in prayer for the personnel committee and our association as we go through this process. We greatly appreciate your prayers, and likewise, let's be praying for Brother Ernie and Sister Renee as they begin this time in their lives of being retired. You know, he's been with the association for 24 years, and so leaving to do something different is going to be quite a change for him. All right. I'd like for us to continue. Remember, Sister Elsie, I did speak with Forrest yesterday, and he was telling me that she's progressing along fine, and he's really pleased with her progress. She is sore because, you know, she's having to do rehab, but she's doing good. I'd like for us also to remember Isabella Sweatman. You know, she's been sick for 2 or 3 weeks now. And finally, and she's been back and forth to the doctor, and they kept thinking that she had strep throat and this and that. Maybe, but she just never could get over it. So Crystal took her yesterday to Children's Hospital, and she stayed there last night. And they're hoping that they can help her. They have run some tests, and which is encouraging. And so let's just remember Izzy, because I know that they're very tired, and they appreciate your prayers. Folks, our prayer list is quite lengthy. I'll read over this, and then if you'd like to comment on any of them when I get finished, just do that. And if you'd like to add any names, you can do that. And so Stacy Requena, Chris and Lindsay Yarbrough, Pat Hart, Chance and Laura Wright, Molly Wilder, Ford Bertram, Avery Ritchie, Wendy Thomas, Pat Flanagan, Bobby Ayers, Jeremy Sands, Donnie Edwards, Lucky Giles, Leland Thompson, Oliver O'Neill, Chris Hernandez, Billy Cecil, Sharon Turner and her husband Rick Turner, Glenda Dean, Brett McDaniel, Joe Rail, Kinley Brantley, Kathy Graves, Eloise Doty, Martha Hudson, Billy Green, Malachi Jackson, Eddie Hill, Zachary King, Billy Joe Green, Martha Holland, Jimmy Meade, Corey Hatcher, Banks Stavos, Reagan Wisnant, Dina McKay, Marty Sargent, Gayla Stewart, Bonnie Copeland, and Clay Engelbert's family. His mom passed away. All right. So are there any comments on any of these? Anyone?
Susan? I want to add Susan Stevenson and from up on Straight Mountain. Their family, she has been put in hospice care, and they're asking for prayers for the family and her. She's been battling cancer, and it's not good, and the family's just, she's been put at ease right now, but they're just praying for peace for the family and all, because she's suffering a great deal. But they've got her pain under management, but she's went downhill pretty fast, and they're not expecting her to make it. But they're just asking for prayers for the family, for peace and comfort for her to go on to be with the Lord.
Susan Stevens. Dana?
My stepdad, Joe Rail, he went to the ENT and they found a mass somewhere, like in his nose cavity, somewhere in there. They don't know if it's a tumor or if it's just soft skin tissue, but he's got to have an MRI done to find out if that's what it is. And if that's what it is, then they think that's the stem of all his problems. So he might not have dementia at all. So just keep praying for him.
Amen.
And then I want to add the Green family. They're my cousins in Mississippi. They just put their father on hospice. And he's got lung and heart issues.
Anyone else?
And I have two more. Ramirez Chavez and his wife Stella. Just remember them. And then a Lindsay Giles. She's a girl, I don't think she's even mine and Joe's age, but she had a stroke and her brain began swelling, and they had to make some alterations for her to have some comfort. But she can speak. She's having some interaction with family, but at that young age and having a stroke and being in a situation, just remember her and the family's asking for prayers.
Okay. Lindsay Giles. Okay. Malia? That's all, folks. All right. I invite you to come to the altar if you'd like to. This is the time that we do this. And let's all stand together. Amen. We have a time of prayer. I encourage you, if you would, pray for your family. I think going over the prayer list and all, looking about the community and things, that we need to be in prayer for our families, don't we? And not a one of us is immune from it. We're all aware of what's going on and the state that we find ourselves with, the community and the country and just the shape that we're in. Most people nowadays don't even fool getting married, right? And you know, that's not right. And it's just a testament to where we are in our country. And we all know that doesn't lead anywhere good, right, when we find ourselves in this situation. So please pray for Please pray for your wife. Please pray for your husband. Please pray for your children. Please, please, I beg you, please pray for them as I lead us in this prayer. Call their names out. It's that important.
And I have an unspoken request, God knows.
Unspoken request, right? And we all have those, right? So please pray for your family while I lead us in prayer. Amen. Let's go, Lord, in prayer. Father in heaven, we come to you again, thanking you for the opportunity to be together. And Lord, we thank you so much for our church, Lord, and what it means to us. It is a blessing to our lives, Lord. We come together and we find this sanctuary, Lord. It's a sanctuary from the world, and it's a sanctuary where we can come and feel safe. And Lord, we're grateful for this, that we're able to come here and be in your presence. And Lord, we ask for your divine leadership. We ask for your divine providence, Lord, that we would take your word and read it and apply it, Lord, to our lives and make it the standard by which we live. And Father, we pray that as we do this, we would feel your presence and know that we are where you would have us to be. Father, we know that there's many, many influences out there, Lord, that are contrary to your word. Father, that's why I ask our people, Lord, to pray for their families. And Lord, I just ask that as we do this and we examine ourselves and we look at ourselves, Lord, that we could make adjustments in our lives that would be pleasing to you. And Father, we don't say these things and we don't pray these things to be critical of anyone, Father. We say these things, Father, and we pray these things because we need you. We need your help. Lord, we are a fallen people. And we ask you, Lord, to come and be among us, Lord, and give us men that love your word. Give us men that will stand boldly and proclaim your word and your truth. And let it ring throughout the cities, Lord, and throughout the churches. And let it take root and grow in our hearts and lives and mold our decisions, Father, that we could see change and see our country, Lord, headed in a direction, Lord, that's pleasing to you. Father, we pray for these names that are on our prayer list, Lord. There are several that, Father, would be here today if they were able to. And we ask you to be with them. I especially lift up Sister Elsie. Just continue to pray for her, Lord, and pray for her family. I know it's a heavy burden, Lord. I want to mention Paula also, her daughter, and just pray that you'd be with her. Father, I'd like to mention Izzy. Father, we just ask you to be with Isabella Sweatman and her mom, Crystal. We pray that you'd be with Jim. We know that, Lord, that they would be here today if they could. And, Father, we pray that you'd be with them. The doctors, Lord, that you could find out what's wrong. Lord, these names, we have many names, Lord, that are on our prayer list because of the COVID. And it's still going around, Father, and it's still serious. And we ask that you'd be with them. I pray for the friend of Malia that she mentioned. They put him on the ventilator, Father. And we just ask that you'd be with him and be with that family, Lord, and be with others, Lord, that are... We've called their names. And Lord, as we think on these things and as we watch and we see the prayers answered and we see people getting better and we see things changing, Father, we want to be sure that we give you the praise and the glory and the honor that you deserve because your word, Lord, is truth. And Father, we believe this with all of our hearts. We lift up our service today, Father. Search out our hearts, we pray. We pray, Father, that you would send the convicting power of your Holy Spirit. And, Father, if there be anything, Lord, within any one of us that you would have us to address, Father, we pray that you would give us the strength and the courage, Lord, to confess these things before you and find ourselves in agreement with you, Lord, that you are right and that your ways are right and your ways are true. We love you. Be with us, we pray now, as we go into our service. In the name of Jesus Christ, I pray for his sake. Amen. Amen. You may be seated.
Amen. This will be our offertory hymn. Please turn to page 313. Page 313. We'll sing verses 1, 2, and 4.
Yeah. Father, we just want to thank you for letting us gather in your house one more time. Father, we just want to thank you for letting us be able to be here. We ask you, thank you, Father, for this beautiful day that we've got to worship you. We ask, Father, that you just take this offering, Father, and use it for the brothers of the kingdom. And Father, there's one here today, Father, that it's just without you, we ask you to just touch your heart, Father, and just bring them to you, Father. We ask you to go with us, be with the preaching hour today, Father, and be with the singing service the rest of the day. Just, Father, we just ask your blessings upon us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen. May we see. Songs. I appreciate it. Another good choice. Thank you. Appreciate it very much. I meant to mention a while ago on the prayer list, so you can add this one, Sister Elsie's daughter, Paula. Is it Love Lady? I think that's right.
I don't know her last name.
I think it is. But anyway, she had a said it was a blood vessel in her brain had ruptured. I said, was it a stroke? He said, no, they didn't call it a stroke. So anyway, she was at the hospital, and they were concerned, but I think she's going to be fine. So anyway, let's add her to our prayer list.
Do you know her last name?
Paula Lovelady, I believe it's Lovelady. Thank you. All right, I'd like to tell you a little bit about the book of Colossians. If you want to be turning there, I'll be reading to begin with chapter 2, verses 1 through 3, the book of Colossians. While you're turning there, I'll kind of give you a little bit of a background there. Acts chapter 18, verses 18 and 19 tell us that Paul left Aquila and Priscilla in Ephesus when he was headed back to Jerusalem at the end of his second missionary journey. That would have been around AD 52. Alright, these dates are important. Helps us to understand the whole message of God's Word. So he left Aquila and Priscilla in Ephesus around AD 52. Study Bible says the church at Ephesus, begun by Priscilla and Aquila, was later firmly established by Paul on his third journey and was pastored by him for some 3 years. So it takes him, what, several months to go to Jerusalem, do his business there, make some, the Passover, I believe it was. He starts another missionary journey, makes his way up to Antioch, comes around, goes to Ephesus because they didn't want him to leave when he stopped by. And so he left Aquila and Priscilla there. And they had planted seeds. And when Paul gets back, he gets that church firmly established in Ephesus. He was there for around 3 years. During that 3 years, a man named Epaphras, so they believe, got saved. Epaphras was from Colossae. Paul had never been to Colossae. Colossae was a city about 100 miles to the east of Ephesus. And so it was the big city. You had Colossae, not that great big of a city. Then you had the big city Ephesus over near the Mediterranean, but anyway, it was by the sea, the Aegean Sea, I believe. And so you would go there to go anywhere. And it was 100 miles to the west of Colossae. You also had Laodicea around 25 miles or so from Colossae. And all those churches there that are in the book of Revelation, you have Laodicea, you have Smyrna, and Pergamos, and those other churches, all are in that area there. And so you see how it all happens. John was at the church in Ephesus there about 95 AD, 30 years or so later from Ephesus, that got exiled over to Patmos, and that's when he wrote Revelation. And so I wanted to give you this time frame of these things. Colossians, the letter, was written between AD 60 and 62. And so what does that tell you? If it was AD 52 when Paul left Aquila and Priscilla there, another 2 or 3 years goes by, the church is firmly established. Another 8 years or so goes by, Paul finds himself in prison in Rome. And so how old is the church in Colossae? It's about anywhere from 5 to 7 or 8 years old in there. It's not that old of a church. So all this is going on. Study Bible says several years after the Colossian church was founded, it's the Colossian church, several years after it was founded, a dangerous heresy arose to threaten it. The heresy contained elements of what later became known as Gnosticism. And my definition of Gnosticism is the worship of education. Basically, that's what it is. People believe that through education, everything can be accomplished. Folks, that is around in our society today, isn't it?
Amen.
We see people that worship education, worship the system that's put forth by the education system. It's not only in the United States, it's everywhere. And so we had elements of this early on. This heresy contained elements of what later became known as Gnosticism. That God is good, but matter is evil. Jesus Christ was merely one of a series of different manifestations, you might say, that God brought along, descending from God, but being less than God. And so this heresy was being taught in that church, or being brought in by some of the people in that young Colossian church. It also said that there was a secret higher knowledge above Scripture that was necessary for enlightenment and salvation. And that sounds a lot like Gnosticism. You have to have a certain knowledge in order to find salvation. All right. Epaphras was so concerned about the heresy that he made the long journey from Colossae to Rome, where Paul was a prisoner. Now, folks, how far is it from Colossae to Rome? I got out my map, and I did some clicking on there, and you can measure it. It's over 1,000 miles by sea. If he got on the boat at Ephesus, he traveled 100 miles, right? Goes 100 miles to Ephesus. If he got on a boat, went over to Corinth, remember? Got off at Corinth, went over to the other side of Corinth, got back on a boat, went on around on up to Rome, is over 1,000 miles if he went by boat. It was 900-something miles if he went by land. If he went around up and went up to went over to Corinth and went on up through, what was it, the Ignatian Way we've talked about. All roads lead to Rome, and you go up there and you cross that other little stretch of water and you go on up through Italy and finally make your way up to Rome. And so what I wanted to point out is that because this false doctrine had started creeping into the church, and evidently these were men that were influential men. But Epaphras, if this is the way it happened, Epaphras was very concerned about what was taking place because it was a great deception that was going on. And the people were placing their faith in something besides Jesus Christ. That was what was happening. This is what this letter to the Colossian church is about. This is what Paul is addressing as he writes this letter, because he wants this young church, even though he had never been there himself. Epaphras had evidently been saved under the preaching of the Apostle Paul at Ephesus some, what, 7 or 8 years earlier. And he had made his way back, started that church. The church started receiving some of this heretical teaching. He ends up going and finding Paul. Said, look, man, I got to tell you what's going on in this little church. And so Paul addresses these things. All right, here's where I am right here. From Colossus to Rome was over 1,000 miles by ship, close to 1,000 miles by land. Birmingham, Alabama to Toronto, Canada is about 950 miles, if it wants to give you some kind of an idea. From Birmingham, Alabama to Toronto, Canada is about 950 miles. That's the level of concern that Epaphras had about these false doctrines. How concerned do we get today over false doctrine? How concerned today do we get over Gnosticism, the worship of education? How concerned today do we get over heresy, heretical teachings that enter the church? Is heresy concerning at all? Is heresy, should heresy, heretical teaching, should it be concerning to us? Yes, it should. It should be. All right, if Epaphras was concerned enough to make a 1,000-mile journey, and if Paul was concerned enough to address his concerns with this much detail, as we read in the book of Colossians, then I believe that we should be concerned enough to understand what was going on. Amen. That way we can know that our faith is where our faith needs to be. All right, Colossians chapter 2, beginning in verse 1. This is the word of God. For I would that you knew what great conflict I have for you and for them at Laodicea, and for as many as have not seen my face in the flesh, that their hearts might be comforted, being knit together in love, and unto all riches of the full assurance of understanding, to the acknowledgement of the mystery of God and of the Father and of Christ, in whom are hid all the treasures of wisdom and knowledge. He kind of sums it all up right there. And he wants to be sure that he's addressing what needs to be addressed. He says there in verse 2, I want you to have the full assurance of understanding to the acknowledgement of the mystery of God. He's talking about Jesus Christ and how Jesus Christ has died for your sin. Verses 3 through 6, after the introduction of verses 1 and 2, Paul begins by thanking God for the gospel message which the Colossians had received. This is in chapter 1. Verses 3 through 6, we read this in chapter 1. We give thanks to God the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, praying always for you, since we heard of your faith in Christ Jesus and of the love which you have to all the saints, for the hope which is laid up for you in heaven, whereof ye heard before in the word of truth of the gospel. The gospel. You heard before in the word of truth of the gospel. Verse 6, which is come unto you, as it is in all the world, and bringeth forth fruit, as it doth also in you, since the day you heard of it, and knew the grace of God in truth. It says there in verse 4, in chapter 1, in verse 4, faith in Christ Jesus. Faith in Christ Jesus. It says there in verse 5, the truth of the gospel. Folks, this is our ground floor. This is what we need. This is what the world needs. This is the gospel message. Jesus Christ, the truth of God's word. Having faith in the blood of Jesus Christ to save us from our sin. Verse 6, everywhere the message of Christ goes, it bringeth forth fruit. Do you agree with that? Do you believe and agree with the fact that everywhere the message of God goes, it can change the hearts and lives of people? Everywhere the gospel message goes, it has a supernatural ability to enter into the person's ears and make a change in a person's lifestyle and make a change for that person for the better. This is the power of the gospel of Jesus Christ. Everywhere the message of Christ goes, it says in verse 6, it bringeth forth truth. Here is the gospel message. This is what needs to be preached. This is where our foundation is. First of all, the prophets spoke of a coming Messiah for thousands of years. That is in the Old Testament. This is part of the gospel message. Jesus Christ is a fulfillment of the Old Testament prophecy. He came, he was born of a virgin, and he came just as the Old Testament prophets prophesied that he would. This is a part of the gospel of Jesus Christ, the good news of Jesus Christ. The coming Messiah would bring salvation from sin in all of its forms and all of its consequences. This is a part of the gospel of Jesus Christ. Jesus Christ, the coming Messiah, would bring salvation from sin in all of its forms and in all of its consequences. Do we need salvation from the consequences of sin today? I ask you that question. Do we? Yes, we do. Friend, I'm telling you, we are having to suffer the consequences of sin. We're having to suffer the consequences not only of our own sin, but of the sin of all those that are around us. You think about the sin that's in the lives of other people that are around you and how it affects you. You think about those things. Jesus Christ came to bring salvation from sin in all of its forms and all of its consequences. This is the message of the gospel. The coming Messiah would set up an eternal kingdom. This is the message of the gospel. Jesus Christ is going to set up an eternal kingdom. Another message of the gospel, the coming Messiah came in the person of Jesus Christ. The coming Messiah of the Old Testament, God himself, God incarnate, came in the person of Jesus Christ. This is the message of the gospel. Jesus Christ is God incarnate. He died for your sin and he arose to prove himself. All who place their faith in him receive supernatural forgiveness from him and supernatural strength from him. Friend, I want to tell you something. When we come to Jesus Christ, we have no strength within ourselves to help ourselves whatsoever. But because of the supernatural strength that comes from him, he will enable us through his Holy Spirit to make those changes in our lives that need to be made. We don't have the strength to make these changes ourselves. What does the education system of the world today tell you? If you'll just go to this program, if you'll just put your money over here, if you'll just go to this rehab place, if you'll just do all this other stuff, none of them ever point you to Jesus Christ. Instead of telling them all those things about where you need to go and what you need to do and how you need to make these lifestyle changes, if we would just give them the good gospel message of Jesus Christ, how he came into this world to die for our sin, how he came into this world to make a change, and how he has the power to enable us through his Holy Spirit to have these changes made. This is what people need to hear. Brethren, what I've given to you is the gospel message. What I've given to you is the place where you need to start. I've given you the beginning of a life and a walk with Jesus Christ. If you don't start here where I have given you this, then I'm telling you, friend, you need to back up. You need to stop and you need to go back to the beginning of your salvation. You need to make sure that you've placed your faith and your hope where your faith and your hope needs to be placed. Because this is the gospel message. This is the message that the Apostle Paul was defending as he wrote this letter to these people at the church in Colossae. In this gospel message, and in this gospel message alone. in this gospel message, and in this gospel message alone, you find chapter 2 and verse 3. I want to read this again. In this gospel message, and in this gospel message alone, you find chapter 2 and verse 3, where it says, all the treasures of wisdom and knowledge. All the treasures of wisdom and knowledge. It says there in verse 3, in whom are hid all the treasures of wisdom and knowledge. You see, God, Jesus Christ, they hold all of the treasures of wisdom and knowledge. When we accept Jesus Christ in our heart, He becomes a part of us. And we have this indwelling Holy Spirit that reveals these truths, these hidden treasures of wisdom and knowledge. I ask you this question. Think about this. Think about it seriously. What more do you need than all wisdom and all knowledge? What more do you need? What more do you need than all wisdom and all knowledge? And when we ask Jesus Christ to come into our heart and our life, we receive the Holy Spirit of God. And He imparts to us that wisdom and knowledge that we need. What more do you need? There are people that will tell you that you need more. This is what this letter is all about. This is what the Apostle Paul is addressing. He says there in verse 8, beware lest any man spoil you. That word spoil, that means lead you astray. He says there in verse 16, let no man therefore judge you. He says there in verse 18, let no man beguile you by trying to place on you more requirements than the gospel message. He says there in verse 18. Let no man beguile. What is it to beguile somebody? It means to trick you, doesn't it?
It says rob. Rob.
Rob. Don't let anybody rob you. Amen. That is placing on you more requirements than the gospel message of Jesus Christ. The gospel message, placing more requirements on you than believing in the supernatural forgiveness that comes from Jesus Christ and the supernatural strength that comes from Jesus Christ. Don't let anybody beguile you into thinking you need more than that. More requirements than believing that Jesus Christ is God incarnate and Jesus Christ died for your sin and arose to prove it. You don't need more than that. You accept that. You believe that. You don't need more than that belief. Placing more requirements on you than believing that Jesus Christ is the prophesied Messiah of the Old Testament. You don't need to believe more than that. You believe Jesus Christ is the prophesied Messiah of the Old Testament. People placing more requirements on you than believing that Jesus Christ is going to set up an eternal kingdom. Do you believe that? Jesus Christ is going to set up an eternal kingdom. You don't need to believe more than that. You believe in that kingdom that's coming. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Amen. You don't need to believe more than that. Placing more requirements on you than believing that Jesus Christ brings salvation from sin in all of its forms and in all of its consequences. You see, Jesus Christ does bring salvation from sin. I don't care what your background is. It doesn't make any difference what your background is. Jesus Christ will save you from your sin. You still may have the consequences of that sin, but He will forgive you of that sin, and He will begin a new life in you from that moment forward. There are men that will tell you there's more to it than just believing what I've told you there. The gospel message. The good news of Jesus Christ. There were men that tried to tell the people in Colossae that there was more to it than that. And it appears that Epaphras was so concerned that he made that trip of over 1,000 miles to Rome to find the Apostle Paul to get the answers that he needed in order to address these men. Notice there it says in verse 8, beware lest any man spoil you through philosophy and vain deceit, after the traditions of men, after the rudiments of the world, and not after Christ. Isn't that interesting? All the other things that the world has to offer, and leaving Jesus Christ out. That's what will happen. That word there, philosophy, vain deceit, traditions of men, and rudiments of the world. Those things will spoil you. What does that word spoil there mean? What is he talking about? Beware lest any man spoil you. My question is, do you want to be spoiled? Don't let any man spoil you. That word spoil there means to carry off as spoil. It means to be led captive. That's what that's talking about. In other words, you listen to what some of these people have to offer, and it'll tie you up for the rest of your life. You'll be searching and looking and trying to find answers for the rest of your life, and you'll never find it. You'll be taken away captive into those beliefs and that belief system instead of finding that life everlasting and that joy and that peace that comes through Jesus Christ. Philosophy, according to the World Book, is the study of the truth or principles underlying all knowledge. You see, there's people that study this. We have an answer in God's Word, don't we? What do we see there in verse 3? Whom are hidden all the treasures of wisdom and knowledge. And that definition of philosophy tells us that there are other people that want to find it in other places besides in God. The study of the truth or principles underlying all knowledge. That's philosophy. Philosophy here in this context is one given to the pursuit of wisdom or learning, and in a narrower sense, one who investigates and discusses the cause of things and the highest good. That means you're trying to find answers for all these problems of the world and completely overlooking God. Unless God and His Word is at the foundation of your philosophy, you're wasting your time. You're just wasting your time. Rudiment, what does that mean? The definition gives us it means the first things from which others in a series or composite whole take their rise. The word denotes a first principle, the ground floor. Where do you start from? Where do Christians start from? The Christians start with God's Word. You take God's Word and everything else springs forth from it. But the rudiments of the world would take something else, someone else's philosophy, and spring forth from the bottom of this. Philosophies, vain deceits, traditions of men, rudiments of the world will rob your time, your talents, and your resources. It will lead you on a wild goose chase and not fill that empty hole that you have in your heart. That's what the world will do for you. You see, there's an empty hole in every man's heart. And that hole can only be filled by Jesus Christ. Because Jesus Christ is the only one that has the power to forgive sin. And when we have our sin forgiven, and we feel that Holy Spirit of conviction come into our heart and life, and we know full well that those burdens are lifted at Calvary, amen? And we walk around a new person because we have those burdens are gone. And we have that new life in Jesus Christ. There's nothing else in all the world that can give you that freedom that you can receive from Jesus Christ. Nothing. You can look for it everywhere, but you can only find that freedom in Jesus Christ. Communism is a philosophy. It is a rudiment. It comes from the education system. Amen. Communism. Socialism is a philosophy. It is a rudiment. You can start everything from the philosophy of socialism. Ground up. Start at the bottom. Build your way up. Conquer the world. Amen. Socialism is a philosophy. Social programs are philosophies. Rudiments. First principles. You take these social programs, you can go down here to the welfare office and go in there and talk to those people in there and they say, we got this program over here. You need to get involved in this program over here. They help you out. Right? That's a philosophy. That's a first principle. You can start right there if you want to. Evolution is a philosophy. You can start right there. You can say, well, the world started out and you had this amoeba there and all these other things started to grow out of it. Eventually, after all these billions of years, we finally got here. Right? You can start out and let that be your ground floor. You see, the world has all of these things to offer. The world has all of these deceptions. And folks, you'll have people coming into your churches and teaching these things that are other things besides the gospel of Jesus Christ. And when we allow these things to have place in our heart and in our mind, it's when we find ourselves being led astray. And we find ourselves being led in directions we had no business going. We end up wasting our time and our talents and our efforts in the wrong places instead of spending those times and those talents and those efforts on serving the Lord Jesus Christ. See, you have the gospel message besides all of these philosophies that the world has to offer. You have the gospel message. Verse 16 says, "Let no man therefore judge you in meat or in drink or in respect of a holy day or the new moon or the Sabbath days." Verse 17, "which are a shadow of things to come, but the body is of Christ." Verse 16, "Let no man judge you because you believe the gospel message is the answer to all of the world's problems." Don't let anybody judge you. Don't let anybody come in and tell you that there's more to it than the gospel message of Jesus Christ. You see, what we believe and we know to be the truth, the gospel message is the answer to all hunger all over the world. The gospel message, the answer to hunger. The gospel message is the answer to hatred all over the world. The gospel message. The gospel message is the answer to divorce all over the world. The gospel message of Jesus Christ. Can you imagine a world with no divorce? The gospel message of Jesus Christ, the answer. The gospel message is the answer to all health issues. It is the answer to all joblessness all over the world, the gospel message. It is the answer to all loneliness, the gospel message of Jesus Christ. You see, the gospel message is what the world needs. The world needs to hear about Jesus. The world needs to hear that Jesus Christ is God incarnate. The world needs to hear that Jesus Christ is returning and He's going to set up that perfect kingdom. And one day, if we receive Him as our personal Lord and Savior, we will be with Him and live with Him for eternity in that eternal kingdom. You see, He's preparing this for us now. He's preparing this as we live this life and as we go through all the trials and tribulations and difficulties that we face in this world today. All these things are opportunities for us to learn. Something that we can have that we can apply to our lives in eternity as we go and we serve Jesus Christ for all eternity in this kingdom that He's going to bring and set up. You see, we're not just living this life for our fancy. We're not just living this life in order to get all we can for ourselves. We're not just living this life in order that we can receive all the pleasure and all the good things that we can muster up. No, we're living this life because God has placed us here for a purpose. He has an eternal purpose for us. And friend, He has an eternal purpose for you. God has a plan for your life. He has usefulness for you. And you will be able to serve Him one day and take your marching orders directly from Him, Jesus Christ. No telling where He will send us in that kingdom that's coming. Are you willing to go? You see, your willingness to serve today is an indication to Jesus of your willingness to serve Him for eternity. Amen. Your willingness to serve Him today, your willingness today to attend church, your willingness today to attend Sunday school, your willingness today to study His Word, your willingness today to do all of these things that are in His Word is an indication to Jesus Christ of your willingness and your desire to be found pleasing to Him for all eternity. Do you want to serve Him for all eternity? Well, do you want to serve Him today? It all ties together. Let no man judge you because you believe the gospel message is the answer to hunger and hatred and divorce and health issues and joblessness and loneliness and all the problems in the world. The gospel message is the answer to these. Verses 18 and 19. Let no man beguile you of your reward in a voluntary humility and worshiping of angels, intruding into those things which he hath not seen, vainly puffed up by his fleshly mind. and not holding the head from which all the body by joints and bands, having nourishment ministered and knit together, increaseth with the increase of God. He's basically telling you there, don't let somebody come in here and tell you what you have to believe. Because there are those that will. Let me read you this in a different translation here. This is from God's Word translation. It's not exactly, it ties along exactly, but it has a really good explanation of this verse. Listen to what it says. Let no one who delights in false humility and in the worship of angels tell you that you don't deserve a prize. Such a person whose sinful mind fills him with arrogance gives endless details of the visions that he has seen. He doesn't hold on to Christ, the head. Christ makes the whole body grow as God wants it to, through support and unity given by the joints and the ligaments. That would be the church. You see what he's talking about? Let no one who delights in false humility. What is humility? Humbleness of mind, meekness, false humility. There are those that would come in and seem so sincere about what they're offering. So delivery and make it sound so appealing. But friend, if you don't offer Jesus Christ, if Jesus Christ is not the foundation of all of those things that are preached from a pulpit, then you don't need to be listening to it. Jesus Christ is that foundation. Humility. God's word for students, it says here in a closing statement, the Bible teaches us what is correct and based on God's word. Amen. I think that's what I've been preaching. The Bible teaches us what is correct and based on God's word. We should be able to decide for ourselves how we live. We shouldn't let anyone else direct our decisions. In other words, we shouldn't be pressured by what's in or who's doing the pressuring. Listen to your own conscience and obey God's word. All these other things that are out there that you have to choose from. I am counseling you today. I'm preaching to you today. I'm giving you advice today. You read God's word. You apply God's word to your heart and to your life. And all these other things will take care of themselves. Brethren, I said to you before, this is the gospel message. This is where you start. If you don't start here, you need to back up. And so I'm asking you to examine your life. How have things been going? Ask yourself. Do you believe that you are responsible for the shape that you're in? Friend, I'm telling you, you are responsible for the shape that you're in. The decisions that you have made have brought you to where you are today. You don't need to blame anybody else. And friend, I'm telling you, I'm giving you the answer right here. I'm giving you the words of life. I'm giving you the gospel message of Jesus Christ. The prophet spoke of a coming Messiah for thousands of years. The anointed one that was coming. They looked for him. They waited for him. Mary, she was so pleased when she found out that she was going to be the mother of the Messiah. The coming Messiah would bring salvation from sin in all of its forms, in all of its consequences. Salvation. We may have consequences of sin today, but friend, I'm telling you, one day, when Jesus Christ returns, everything is going to be made right. We have that promise. We have that hope today. Jesus Christ, the coming Messiah, would bring salvation from sin in all of its forms, in all of its consequences. The coming Messiah would set up an eternal kingdom. The coming Messiah came in the person of Jesus Christ. Jesus Christ is God incarnate. He died for your sin and arose to prove himself, to prove that he had the power to forgive you of your sin. All who place their faith in him receive supernatural forgiveness and supernatural strength from him. Do you need that supernatural forgiveness today? Do you need it? It is there for the world. Jesus Christ was so serious about forgiving your sin that he went to the cross and suffered and bled and died that you might have forgiveness of sin. Do you need that forgiveness today? Amen. Thank you. And if you would come, lead us in a song of invitation. Folks, this song of invitation is just that. I ask you, don't quench the moving of the Holy Spirit. If the Holy Spirit is convicting you today, anything in your life, you come ahead and you come to this altar today. We'll pray with you. We met at the altar last week. It was such a joy and such a refreshing to come and have people at the altar praying. And I ask you today, if there's one here in the sound of my voice that needs to come and pray, come ahead. We'll pray together. Amen? All right, let's all stand and sing.
Page 433. I surrender all.
Yeah, it's good, isn't it? It's good. Thank you. Anyone else for what?
What you were saying today up there, if you believe in Jesus Christ, you're richer than the richest man around.
Amen. That's right. All the riches in glory. Joint heirs with Jesus. Joint heirs. Can you imagine? Can you imagine Jesus walking into this place? His Holy Spirit is here with us today. Anyone else a word? Brother Kozad, would you dismiss us, please?